Hello, my name is Shlomo Maital. I'm a professor of management here at the Technion, actually retired. And my friend Ralph Haller has kindly asked me to speak to you through videotape about Israel, my country, startups, entrepreneurship, Israeli innovation. And I'm very pleased to be with you. I've decided to frame my talk in terms of due diligence. Many of you management students will work for consulting companies or even large global companies, and you may well find yourself doing a due diligence process. As you know, due diligence means doing your homework before you sign a contract, for example, acquiring a company. So my youngest son worked for a consulting company in Boston, and much of what he did was to go to companies and take an x-ray and examine every scrap of paper. So let's do due diligence for what is called Startup Nation, the name that Israel brands itself with. And let's ask, is Israel worth acquiring? Would you acquire Israel if you could, and how much would you pay if you could actually acquire a country? This is an exercise you may find yourself doing as a global manager. Should we go into Moldova, Macedonia, Croatia, China, and so on? And how do you know? How do you really do an x-ray of a country? So we'll do that with Israel, and we'll look at the bright side of the moon and some of the dark side aspects as well. And we'll do some comparisons with Switzerland, the country where you're studying, and the country that you're very familiar with. So we begin with a contrast between Switzerland and Israel. I once wrote a column for a magazine called Swissreal and asked what would happen if there was a friendly merger between Switzerland and Israel, because in some ways it makes a lot of sense. So Switzerland's a remarkable country. It's about the same population as Israel, 8.5 million. About twice the area in terms of Israel's 67 borders, if you mind. And Switzerland is more than twice as wealthy as Israel, with per capita GDP of $78,000 measured by purchasing power, compared to $36,000 for Israel. So the first clue we have about Israel is that with all this bonded entrepreneurship and high tech, our GDP is still well below that of world leaders. How come? And I'll try to answer that question for you. Switzerland, according to the IMD World Competitiveness Yearbook, is second in the world in global competitiveness. This is quite remarkable, because Switzerland has the world's strongest currency. How can you be globally competitive when your products are so expensive? And the simple answer is because your products are very high quality. So in terms of due diligence, I want to recommend this wonderful yearbook, the IMD World Competitiveness Yearbook, put out every year in June by the Business School in Lausanne, IMD. And this is a great source of information for 80 countries that are globally competitive. And I've made use of that in my presentation today, and I recommend it to you. I use it a lot. So we see for Switzerland some of the challenges facing Switzerland in coming years. Preventing protectionism, reforming corporate taxes, which are a bit high, and your social welfare and pension system. Switzerland has something of a pension problem. Every country in the West has a looming pension crisis, including Israel. In terms of competitiveness, the IMD benchmarks four dimensions: economy, government, business, and infrastructure. And the profile for Switzerland, as you can see, is relatively flat. And Switzerland is consistently excellent in almost everything. The one exception you can see in the diagram is in prices. Switzerland's a really expensive country, in part because it is so wealthy, and in part because your currency is so strong that prices of goods and imports especially are really high. But you see a picture of overall excellence across these four dimensions. And according to the IMD report, the reasons Switzerland is attractive, it's a stable and predictable country, excellent education, skilled workforce, good infrastructure, and an R&D culture. You'll see in a moment that many of the strengths of Switzerland are echoed in the strengths of Israel as well. Israel is 22nd in global competitiveness. This has been fairly stable, down from 19th in 2013. Israel faces a lot of challenges. Many of those challenges come from the fact that we're in the Mideast, which is not a great neighborhood in which to be. We have bureaucracy. We need to boost our exports, which have been rather weak. We have a large public sector. We don't have a lot of long-term thinking. Perhaps characteristic of a country living in a bad neighborhood and facing almost daily crises. The competitiveness landscape of Israel is a bit more like the Alps. It's not very consistent. You can see strengths there in technology and science infrastructure, and weaknesses in some aspects of the economy, government, and business efficiency, and some problems with infrastructure. Our infrastructure leaves much to be desired. As in Switzerland, we have a strong R&D culture, some good universities, a fairly skilled workforce, and a dynamic economy reflected in the number of startups and the willingness of young people to take risks and start a business facing steep odds. And I'll talk about that a little more in a moment. Now, I found a way to present the following fact. Israel has excellence in science, technology, and innovation, but that excellence, we don't reap the fruits of that excellence sufficiently in our economy. And I've shown it by what I call the wheels of life. So you could do a radar diagram, pick 5, 6, 7, 8 variables, key variables, reflecting each of these five dimensions: environment, science, society, innovation, and in the middle, economy. Pick the key variables and then plot Israel's rank among 80 countries, according to the IMD, where a very low rank, 80th, puts the point right at the center, and a very high rank, number one, puts it way out on the circumference of the radar diagram, of the circle. So the size of the radar diagram, the area that it subtends, indicates excellence. And you can see the brownish science and technology radar diagram, big, the innovation, blue, purple, big, environment and society, somewhat smaller. And then in the middle, the economy, rather small, $36,000 GDP per capita. If we're the startup nation, if we're so smart, how come we aren't rich? And that's an issue I want to talk about, why Israel hasn't really reaped the benefits of this dynamism, creativity, and entrepreneurship that you see everywhere. Israel ranks 22nd in the world in innovation. This is the Global Innovation Index. That's declined since 2014. We invest heavily in R&D. Some of that is military R&D, but there's a lot of spillover from military R&D to civilian uses. You see that China and South Korea are rapidly boosting their R&D spending, and South Korea has already caught up with Israel. We have some weaknesses in innovation, insufficient capital spending on communication. Our internet speed is one half that of Korea. This is not appropriate for a startup nation that makes its living from a lot of startups in the area of software. It doesn't allow us really to have people work at home with slow internet. And part of the reason is a monopolistic structure of our communications industry. A former monopoly of telephone services called Bezeq that was privatized poorly privatized, and much of the profits of Bezeq had gone to the owners who bought it on debt and used the profits to pay the debt rather than invest in infrastructure. Now, we'll start with the bright side of the moon and then look at the dark side. So, young Israelis, more than perhaps any other country that I know, young Israelis dream of launching a startup. 77% of our students in science and technology in college say they dream of launching a startup one day. A third of those, 34%, say they will do it soon, and 43% say in the future, after they get some experience, learn a bit, save a bit of money. And this percentage is actually rising. I don't think there's any other country that can match that phenomenal percentage of young people who want to do startups. That's the bright side. How do you explain that? It's part of our culture, and later I'll show you Israel's innovation ecosystem. And you'll see that many of the elements of that ecosystem are based on culture. Culture is shared values. What's important to the people. And Israelis are independent. We don't like people telling us what to do. And our young people will leave excellent jobs with great companies like Intel and Microsoft and others. And they will quit when their ideas are not listened to. And they go off and start their own businesses facing really horrendous risks that I will show you in a moment. So this is the bright side. This underlying culture of startups and fearless desire to be independent and to change the world. This is not driven, by the way, by the search for great wealth. That's not the story. The story is influence, impact, change the world, do something significant, make your life meaningful. I've taught MBA students in a lot of countries, in France and Germany and Singapore, many countries, US, elsewhere. I often teach engineers, talented engineers. France has among the best engineers in the world, so does Switzerland. France's Ecole de Mines is over 200 years old. French engineers design Suez Canal and Eiffel Tower and many wonderful things. My French engineering students are not super keen on starting a business. It's risky, it's difficult, you have to deal with bureaucracy. Closing a business in France is really, really hard because you have to fire people. Why do it when you can have a secure job and 6 weeks of vacation? While a startup means you have to work 24/7, forget about vacations for years. Israeli young people, they are gung-ho on startups. What's the dark side of the moon? What is the aspect of Israel, startup nation, that many people don't discuss and that troubles me and that we need to address? So here are the numbers. Here are the data. This is a study done by Israel Venture Center. They studied 10,000 startups in the period of 1999 to 2014 and tracked them down one by one and examined whether they are successful or failed or zombies. They're still alive, but they're not doing anything. So let's look at the numbers. Of 100 startups, of every 100 startups, only 4 really succeed in terms of being profitable, returning the rate of return on investment that's reasonable, and independent. 4 of 100 startups in this period succeeded. That's a success rate of 4%, 96% failure. And many of those that succeeded actually are acquired. So only 4 of 500 are successful and growing and are independent. So Israel creates startups, most of them fail, some of them are acquired, a very small number remain independent. None of the independent ones have achieved truly global size in over 20 years. Our last global startup was called Checkpoint. It started in 1993, or Amdocs, around the same time. Since then, we have not created a global independent company from a startup. So the red are failed companies. The orange are companies that are still running but are not successful. There are a lot of those. Just too much trouble to close them. And the green are companies that are successful. And you can see that the odds are rather horrendous. And the question is, how come young people, despite this, continue to launch startups at a high rate? Are they unaware of the odds? Are they unrealistic, or are they defying the odds? I think the answer is the latter. I think they're simply defying the odds, assuming that they can succeed, they are able to do it. The big question is why? How come so many startups fail? And I have a simple explanation. Many people disagree. But I think I have an initial answer. So I teach at the Technion. I've been here teaching entrepreneurs, teaching engineers for over 30 years, since 1979, soon almost 40 years. Technion engineers and scientists study hard. We put their feet to the fire. They learn cutting edge science and technology. They tackle hard problems. And many of them have the idea that they're going to launch a startup. We did research, we surveyed Technion graduates, and we asked them, how many of you have launched startups? One Technion graduate in every four launches a startup business, their own business. One in four. And even among the women, one woman in seven graduate starts a business, does a startup. So why do they fail? I think they fail because, by nature, engineers and scientists focus on technology in their startups. They have magical technology. They create a product or a service that is truly, truly magical. The problem is that a startup is a business, not just technology. And our wonderful graduate engineers and scientists have very little knowledge of basic business principles. And they learn business as they launch their startup, but very often don't learn quick enough, and the business fails. They make basic mistakes. And in a moment, we'll discuss a case study of a company called Better Place, which had a wonderful idea and a brilliant entrepreneur and $850 million. So they sure weren't underfinanced. And they failed because of some really basic business mistakes. So this troubles me a lot here at my university at Technion, and I think we should do a lot more to try to provide some basic business tools for our engineering and science students. This is a hard sell because it's all that our faculties can do to teach the science and the engineering, and they're reluctant to waste time on things like business. But we need to deal with this high failure rate and try to get it down, and some basic business education could be helpful. Here's another myth that you may have heard that I'd like to try to dispel. So Israel has a number of venture capital companies. Many of them are American-based and have branches here in Israel. Venture capital companies pitch the idea that they can pick winners and that they can make very high returns, and we hear a lot of stories about exits in which venture investors make 10, 20, 30 times their original investment. Here are the numbers for Israeli VCs established around 2004 and those established since 2007. For four companies established in 2004, one of them lost heavily. Some made minimal returns, one reasonable return, but they all four, made less of a return than the stock market index, which more than doubled between 2004 and the current period. The stock market index, Tel Aviv 100, went up 133%. None of the VC funds made that. And for those established since 2007, three of three of them lost money while the stock market index went up. So the myth is that venture capitalist companies know how to pick winners, and the truth is they're rather poor at that. And there are many reasons, but it's something to be taken into account. Now, I want to talk to you about the virus. In Israel, startup entrepreneurship is viral. And many countries, I think, would like this to happen. They would like this good virus to spread from one person to another. And there are ways to make that happen. But I want to tell you a story about a visionary entrepreneur who wasn't satisfied with just his own success. He wanted it to spread, and he found a way to make that happen. So I'm talking about an entrepreneur named Yehuda Zisapel. And here is his story. 1981, Yehuda was a distributor for Motorola products. Motorola told Yehuda, "We don't need you anymore. We're going to distribute our own products in Israel." And that basically put Yehuda's company out of business. So he had to find a product to sell. And he decided that he and his brother Zohar would design a product, their own product. They would do it quickly, and they would make something that they knew there was a market for, and then sell it. And so they designed a high-quality, low-cost modem. Many young people don't know what a modem is, but we used to connect to the computer via phone lines. And the modem was the device that connected our computers to phone lines. This was successful, and the company they started called RAD sold these modems, became profitable. And then Yehuda encountered a problem that many companies encounter. And the problem is this. You have talented R&D engineers. Some of you are R&D engineers, probably. The engineer comes to the CEO of the company and says, "Boss, I've got a great idea." And the boss has a dilemma. Companies need to be focused. RAD was focused on low-cost, high-quality motors. People came with ideas for software. We're not a software company. We don't know the market. So if you brush off the engineer and throw him out of your office, you have an unhappy camper. But if you try and implement his idea, your company loses focus and spreads its resources too thinly. What do you do with creative people who have ideas that can't really implement in your company? And Yehuda's answer, right from 1981, was simple. You know, he told these engineers, "We can't really do your idea in our company. We're a motor company. But I have an office next door, empty office. Why don't you go next door, and why don't you launch a startup? See what you can do. See if you can make your product successful. And we're right here next door. We'll give you advice. If you want advice on marketing, HR, finance, economics, all of that, we'll share our experience with you. We'll help you. We might even invest a bit in your company as well." Well, if you look at this diagram, all the little colored dots and triangles and squares and circles, 128 companies sprang up from the mothership RAD over the years in waves. And half of them are in the same area in North Tel Aviv, where the mothership is, RAD. And they jog together, and they play tennis together, chat, share information, and they have this powerful informal network. And these companies have a 70% success rate, which is far above the normal success rate for a startup. Why? Because they have access to all of this management and business experience. The constraint on Israeli startup success is not money, and it's not technology, it's management savvy. And in a moment we'll see a case study of why that is really true. So this is a way of solving the problem that our engineers graduate knowing all about thermodynamics, but very little about writing a business plan and raising money. This is a model that other companies can apply because it turns out to be very powerful, and much more powerful than incubators. It's a kind of an incubator, but a very, very focused and practical one. So I need to tell you some stories and give you some examples, because so far we've talked in generalities. Let me tell you the story of a company called Mobileye, which has lately been in the news. And here's the story. I think this is an instructive story because it tells you some of the details of how culture drives innovation. The two men in the picture are the founders of Mobileye. On the left, you can see Professor Amnon Shashua. And he's a professor of computer science at the Hebrew University, one of our leading universities. And he's an expert on computer vision. And that's his research and has been from the beginning of his career. The man on the right is named Ziv Aviram. And he's the founding CEO and still the CEO of Mobileye. And Ziv Aviram has a background in publishing, in marketing. He's not an engineer. He's not a scientist. He's a professional manager and has run conventional companies, not in the world of high tech. So in 1998, Professor Shashua was at a conference. It was a conference on computer vision, and the car companies had sent some of their engineers to the conference, and they had a question for Professor Shashua, an expert on computer vision. They asked him this: how many cameras do we need in a car to set up a system where the cameras will warn the car that it's too close to the next car or that it's going to be in a crash? How many cameras do we need? Now, human beings have two eyes. The reason we have two eyes is so that we can see depth, because the two eyes triangulate and we can tell whether something is far or near with those two eyes. If you close one eye, it's very hard to have depth perception because you don't have the triangulation. So the car companies assumed that they needed at least two cameras and probably three. Professor Shashua said, one camera. I can give you a warning system with one camera in the car. And they said, that's impossible, you're unrealistic, you're just a theoretical professor. Israelis really like it when people tell them you can't do something. But we are stubborn enough to go off and do it anyway. Shashua went home, started a company, late 1998, called Mobileye, recruited his friend, Ziv Aviram, they used to bike ride together, and they launched a company and began to work on developing a warning system for cars based on a single camera. And the idea was that when the camera sees an image at two points in time, comparing the two images can give you depth perception. You use time to get depth perception rather than two or three different cameras. So they wrote software, algorithms, Professor Shashua was good at that, developed their own chip, and this was crucial, this was a crucial decision. Instead of outsourcing the chip design and production, they decided they would produce it themselves because this was the core technology. And you never outsource core technology to somebody outside the company. It's like giving away the family jewels. So it took a long time. The first product didn't come until 2007. Ziv Aviram decided to raise money in a creative way. You know, innovation is not just about gadgets. It's about how you build a business, how you run the business. And Ziv Aviram did not want to go to venture capitalists. Venture capital is very impatient. Venture capital raises money, sets up a fund, invests the money, and then they have to give back the profits to the investors in 5, 6, maximum 7 years. That's not long enough. Mobileye didn't have a product until 2007. So Ziv Aviram simply went to wealthy angel investors, made the pitch, explained the idea, told them they have to be patient, and raised money in that fashion. Raised very, very patient money. The rest is history. This year, I think in March, or in May, sorry, Mobileye was sold to Intel for $15 billion. Intel is now making Mobileye the R&D center for self-driven vehicles for autonomous vehicles, an industry that everybody thinks is going to be very, very big, and Intel is using Mobileye to get into this, and bought the company for $15 billion, making the founders billionaires, and raising a question. Is this good for Israel? Is this a good business model? To start companies and then sell them, even for astronomical prices? Does this benefit our country? Are we selling our brains? Could we have developed Mobileye into a great global company to the benefit of the people of Israel? But maybe this R&D center in Jerusalem that will employ hundreds and hundreds of engineers, maybe this will be a good thing. So there are many questions about our exit strategy. Starting companies, selling them, selling our brains for high prices, is this the best that we can do? So I need to share with you a failure story, not just a success story. Many of you have heard of Elon Musk's company Tesla. And Tesla is now selling successfully battery-driven electric cars in America. They're beautiful, sexy, well-designed, appealing, cool cars. They're starting to sell them now for a low price, $35,000 for Model S. Elon Musk is changing the world by creating cars that don't run on a drop of gasoline. Well, Israel and Better Place should actually be Tesla. Shai Agassi, an Israeli, brilliant, precocious Israeli. He had startups at a very, very young age, made a great deal of money, was acquired by SAP, German company, almost got the top job in SAP, had a falling out, came home, and had a vision. I can make cars that run only on electricity, not on gasoline. This, by the way, is a strategic issue for Israel, because many of Israel's hostile Arab neighbors are oil-rich countries, and the reduction in the price of oil in some ways reduces their geopolitical influence. So Agassi had a kind of a geopolitical agenda and not just a startup one. And he founded a company based on his reputation, his pitch, the idea, the vision, all of these things. He raised a huge amount of money. Now, believe it or not, many startups fail because they run out of money. This is a startup that failed because it had too much money. And I remember visiting their headquarters and looking at all the sumptuous furnishings and the ambience of the place, reflecting the $850 million that they raised in capital. People stood in line to invest in Better Place. It was a sure thing. Better Place declared bankruptcy in May of 2013. That's 4 years ago. Why did they go bankrupt? Better Place was a software company and a battery company. The idea was to take cars, to run the cars on an electric battery. The range of the car wasn't far, 100 kilometers or so. For a small country like Israel, that's okay. Not good for bigger countries. They had a beautiful system for driving into a battery station. A robot would remove the old battery, replace it with a new battery, and in the same time that it takes to fill your tank with gasoline, off the car would go. Sounds like a terrific model, and they had 21 battery replacement stations set up in Israel. Why did they go bankrupt? They went bankrupt, I think, because believe it or not, Better Place, being a car company, in the end, the product is a car, they really didn't have people who understood the car business. Now, the car they chose to put their electric battery in was a Renault Fluence. Why the Renault Fluence? I think it wasn't easy to find a car company that was willing to cooperate with them. And Renault was one of the few companies, or maybe the only company, that was willing to do that, Renault Nissan. I don't know if you're familiar with the Renault Fluence. It's a big, clunky car. It's not a Tesla. It's not beautiful. It's not sexy. And it's not a car that Israelis would normally buy. not a car that was popular here. The fact that it ran on battery power, some Israelis like that. It's a green car. But in the end, you're buying a car, not an ideology or a principle. And personally, I don't think I would buy a Renault Fluence, and many Israelis decided the same. And the company simply didn't sell. It didn't have clients. And the company declared bankruptcy. They tried to sell their assets. Nobody wanted it. And in the end, someone acquired their assets for $450,000, $500,000. $850 million of money was evaporated or burned up by a better place. It's a shame. Not a total loss. People got experience. Many engineers got experience. But there's a lesson here. A startup is a business. And you need people who understand the industry that you're working in. And you need people with management skill. Mobileye had an experienced, savvy CEO, not an engineer. Someone with business experience. I think Better Place lacked that. So moving toward our conclusion, let me just talk about the big picture after we looked at some case studies and show you a map that we've done about Israel's innovation ecosystem. So a colleague and I have written a book called Mapping National Innovation Ecosystems, and we've studied eight countries or regions, including China, Shanghai, Israel, Germany, France, Canada, and so on, and done these maps based on what experts tell us. And we found that every country has a different innovation ecosystem, and a crucial part of that ecosystem is what we call the culture of the country. So looking at Israel's innovation ecosystem, you can see out-of-the-box thinking, a culture of empowerment, cultural diversity. Israel is an immigration country. We have people who have come here from Europe, Eastern Europe, Asia, from North Africa, North America, many countries. We're a diverse country. We have a lot of government support in various ways. What used to be the office of the chief scientist. The government actually started Israel's venture capital industry. The government launched many incubators in the 1990s. We got a tremendous influx of first-rate Russian human capital, a million Russian immigrants during the 1990s, and that turned out to be crucial in fueling Israel's high-tech boom. But the point of this innovation ecosystem is that it's culture in the end that drives it. This culture of empowerment, of low power distance, young people who are confident, who are determined to be independent, to change the world, and this seems to drive the system. Every country has a different ecosystem. Singapore spent a lot of money trying to import Silicon Valley. Singapore is not California, and this was doomed to fail from the outset. Yesterday I met with some visitors from Japan, and Japan doesn't have a lot of startup activity. And we discussed how to do that, how to encourage it. And I tried to make the point that you can't import Israel's system, you can't import Silicon Valley. Japan has to build on its own culture and its own history. And if Japan does have an innovation ecosystem, it will be Japanese and not American or Israeli or anything else. Ralph asked me to talk a bit about the history. So very briefly, here is a short description of how Israel's high-tech startup industry began. And it began thanks to the man on your left, President Charles de Gaulle of France. So we go back to 1967. And the Six-Day War. And during and after that war, Israel used French Mirage jets. France was the main supplier of Israel's Air Force. The Air Force, of course, was crucial in defending our country. De Gaulle was upset with Israel about the Six-Day War and declared an embargo on spare parts and military equipment to Israel. We were left with Mirage planes without parts and without French support. Big crisis. And that meant that we had to sit down and do our own stuff. We had to design and build our own military technology. So this man on the right, named Uziel Galil, Technion graduate, he had studied at Purdue University. He had learned the American R&D system, industrial R&D, came back to Israel, launched a startup, one of the first, now called Elbit. Some of the things that Elbit made were to supply the Defense Department in Israel with needed parts and equipment. Israel began designing and making its own air-to-air missiles, something other countries didn't want to supply us with. And so the bottom line here is that sometimes necessity is the mother of invention. That's a cliche in English, but indeed, countries that need things and can't get them elsewhere, that's a great spur to creativity. Small countries sometimes don't believe in themselves. Israel in 1967, and I first came to Israel in that year, and I remember this, Israel did not have a lot of self-confidence that a small country, 3 or 4 million, could make really great high-tech advanced things up to an American or French standard. But when we had to do it, and we did it, we proved to ourselves, hey, we can do this. So self-confidence is an important part of a small country's startup culture. Just the belief in yourself, we're smart, we can do this. And at one point, Israel even designed its own jet fighter aircraft, the Arrow. And that turned out to be not economical to produce, but the plane itself was beautiful, functional, and first rate, unusual that a country so small could actually do this. So I think I'll conclude here. I'm very happy to engage in dialogue with any of you who have questions. If you have ideas for a startup, I have a lot of people exchanging ideas with me. I keep secrets very well. And I'd be really, really glad to hear from you if you have questions about Israel, about business plans, ideas, and so on. I'm an economist, not an engineer, but I know a bit about some technologies and would be very happy to dialogue with you. So thank you for your attention, and Ralph will supply you with a file of my slides. I wish you great success in your studies, great success afterwards, and I'd like to end with this thought. You have many options as graduates of an excellent MBA program. You have experience, energy, courage, ability. Think about a startup as a possible option. Think about how you can change the world and create value. Think about something you're passionate about. Think about something people need. Think about something that you yourself need. Great products were founded by people who themselves wanted to have it, and it didn't exist. So they didn't do market research, they were themselves their own market research. And they worked hard and created the product or the service, and it turns out that a lot of other people actually needed it as well. I wish you great success. Goodbye, regards to my friend Ralph, and enjoy your studies.